Hey guys, welcome back to my channel and welcome back to another video in the series of An American Being Abroad. So my name is Anika, and if you guys have not seen my previous videos or have just stumbled across my channel, I am actually an American living abroad. I am currently an American living in London, but I have lived abroad for over 9 years now. And before London, I was living in Germany for 4 years and now London for 5 years. And today I thought I would talk to you guys all about the life in the UK test. So this video is made for anyone who has lived in the UK for up to 5 years and is looking to apply for their indefinite leave to remain or their British citizenship. As an American, after 5 years of living in the UK, you can actually apply for indefinite leave to remain. And what that means is it means a permanent residency, which means you are no longer tied to working for a certain company or having a certain visa in place in order to be able to work and live in the UK. You're basically a resident or a British citizen without having a passport. So an indefinite leave to remain kind of gives you all the bells and whistles, all the rights of a British citizen, but again, no passport. But it allows you to continue to stay in the UK for as long as you like, as long as you maintain the rules around indefinite leave to remain. So in today's video, I wanna give you guys my real life experience of taking the Life in the UK test. Now, I have recently taken and passed the test. And I wanted to share my entire experience with you guys and share some tips, best practices, and also some real life examples of some practice test questions that were actually on my real test. So if you guys want to know more about the Life in the UK test, how to pass it, and my entire experience on it, stay tuned until the end of the video to learn all my tips and tricks. So this test is purely made up to test your knowledge of British history, British pop culture, and just life in the UK. And it also is there to test your understanding of the English language, just in case English is not your first language. So the Life in the UK test is made up of 24 questions, and it's a test that you're going to have to take on a computer. And in order to pass the test, you are going to have to answer 18 out of those 24 questions correct, or 75% correct. So when you go take that test, they actually don't even tell you which questions you get right or wrong. All it is a pass or a fail. So once you clear 18 questions correct, that's it. You've passed, congratulations, you're done with the test. But if you don't actually hit the 18 question mark, then actually you have failed. So it's really just once you hit 18, you've passed, and then if you don't, then you have failed. Also, something very important for you guys to know is that the test costs £50 every single time you take it. Hopefully after watching this video and a little bit of studying on your part, you actually only have to take it one time. And another thing to note is if you do fail, then you have to wait 7 days before you rebook your test, and then you have to pay £50 again. But when you do pass the test, hopefully on your first time, that's it. That's the only time you have to take the test. It is only required one time for your indefinite leave to remain visa. Or if you decide to later apply for your British citizenship, that's it. You have that test, you finished it, you passed it, you have the certificate that says you've passed, and that's all. That's it, only one time. So that £50 fee is only a one-time fee if you pass on your first time. So guys, before I jump into my top tips on how to prepare for this test, I want to recommend that you guys use the official Life in the UK book to study for your test. Now you can find that on any government website that is referring to the Life in the UK test, or there are a number of copies on Amazon that are new or used, or if you want to, you can always visit your local library if they are open to check it out as well. But I would recommend buying the book. It is helpful to be able to highlight in it, write in it. You can either buy the hard copy or you can download an e-version, which is what I did. I will make sure to link everything I'm talking about in this video down in the description for you guys. So before I jump into the actual questions that you will end up seeing on the test, I want to give you guys 6 practical tips on how you can successfully pass your Life in the UK test the first time. My first tip is to buy the official study guide that I have already linked down below in the description and I've talked about already. Either buy the hard copy or download the e-version, whichever you want, but use that official book to study for this test. There are going to be a lot of online websites, a lot of apps out there that are gonna say they're the official, like, Life in the UK study guide. They are not. They actually take questions from the original study guide and make them more convoluted, difficult, harder to answer, and it really messes with you when you can't pass those tests. So I would recommend always getting the most up-to-date version of the test booklet that you can study from. I got the 2019 version. I took my test in 2020. I don't think 1 year difference makes that big of a deal, but don't try to buy something that's 10 years old because it's just not going to work. But again, I will link it down below if you guys are interested in that specific book, but I would recommend getting that book and not just using random websites that say Life in the UK test. My second tip for you guys today is to take the practice test first. So what I mean by that is when you buy the Life in the UK booklet, it comes with a whole bunch of information about the history of the UK, the monarchs, everything you can imagine about being British, really, and British pop culture. Instead of just reading that whole book through, what I would recommend is going to the back of it. There's about 12 practice tests in the back of the book. And when you go back there, I would recommend going through all those 12 practice tests first. Answer all the questions. Doesn't matter if you get them right or wrong. Hopefully you get more right than wrong. But regardless, answer them all. And then that's kind of the standard that you set for yourself based on what you already know. So if you already know about, you know, King Henry VIII, or if you already know about the Beatles or whatever other information you know about British history and British culture, then you don't have to re-study it. Once you take those tests and you then find out which ones you've gotten incorrect, so which ones that, you know, you didn't really know or you took a total guess on, then the book actually tells you which chapters those questions are correlated to, and then you should go back and study that and then take the test again and see if you've actually absorb that material. So in order to save you a little bit of time, I guess, instead of reading everything like 10 times over, take the test. What you don't know, study that over and over again, and then take the test again. Hopefully you will have passed it the second time around. So my third tip for you guys is to start studying a little bit earlier than later. Cramming never works. I know that I was studying my flashcards like hours before the test, and funny enough, none of those flashcards actually even stuck in my mind when I was taking the test. But I started studying for the test about 2 weeks before my actual test date, so I would recommend a minimum of 2 weeks to give yourself. Obviously, give yourself more time if you have the time, but 2 weeks is a good starting point, and just don't cram everything into the last few days or the last few hours, because none of that's gonna actually stick in your head. My fourth tip for you guys is to focus on the monarchs, what they did, when they lived or died, and what significance they had. And the main reason is there is probably going to be at least one question on your actual test about some sort of British rule or monarch, and that is just because the British Empire and the British monarch is the longest standing monarch in history. So they have hundreds of thousands of years of history on it. So they are probably actually more than likely going to ask you a question about that. I know I had two questions on my test about British monarchs. So just be very clear who came after who and what they were like known for. Like, for example, like Mary, Queen of Scots, like, you know, and Queen Elizabeth, they were cousins and that kind of relationship. And also, were they actually, you know, friendly cousins, or did they kill each other? That kind of information is what you have to retain, because those are the type of questions that will likely be asked in the test. And I'll get to practice questions later in this video. My fifth tip is to take as many practice tests as you possibly can. Now, once you have read through the study guide, and once you've taken the official practice test in the back of that study guide, I would recommend repeating that, because repetition helps you remember things. But also, there are a number of apps and a number of trusted websites that have timed practice tests that also tell you if you've done it incorrectly or correctly, and also give you the correct answers if you have done it incorrectly. I will link all of the information, all of the data down below, so you can check out all those websites if you are keen on those. But really, just take the time to do as many practice tests as possible. Don't rush through them, but try to expose yourself to as many questions as possible, because a lot of times on the actual test, what they will do is they will take one of the practice test questions that you've come across, but maybe change one word to like don't versus had done or something like that, or true versus false. They will change up the wording. So just take those practice tests and try to remember the context of those questions, so when it comes up again, you're able to answer them on the real test. And finally, my sixth tip for you today is to not rush. Now, I fell into this trap and I was rushing through a lot of my practice tests, and I was getting things wrong carelessly because I didn't read through the question fully. Now, when you take this test for real, okay, there are 24 questions. You have 45 minutes. That is so much time. You honestly will leave with so much time if you rush through it. Take your time, read through the question fully, make sure you understand it fully, and then read through every one of the answers and start eliminating the ones you definitely know are not right, and then obviously pick what you know is correct. If you know what's correct right away, pick that answer, but just don't rush. Remember to read through the question. Even if you think you know the answer, like I said earlier, sometimes they say true versus false, or they change a year around, or they change a monarch's name around. They'll try to trick you in that way. So try to remember to keep your mind clear and focused and read through every one of those questions and don't rush it. So guys, for the next part of this video, I want to go over three questions that were in my practice test, so the official study guide practice test, that actually ended up being on my real test. So this was word per word on my real test. So these practice tests that you get in the official study guide, they are actually pulling questions from the real test. Remember, when you are given those 24 questions in the real test, it's just a random 24 questions that they pick from a pool of questions and then you're given them. But I have three questions that I like remember seeing on practice tests that I wanna share with you guys today. So I'm gonna read you guys my three questions that came up on my test. So these are real questions from my test that I remember. First one is, which is the largest expanse of fresh water in mainland Britain? Lake Windermere, Loch Lomond, Derwentwater, or Loch Ness? And the correct answer is Lake Windermere. The next question that came up on my test was, which famous playwright and actor was born in 1564 in Stratford-upon-Avon? Richard Arkwright, Thomas Hardy, Geoffrey Chaucer, or William Shakespeare? The correct answer is William Shakespeare. And then finally, I'm pretty sure that this question is going to definitely come up on your test because it's a very important year to remember. So the question is, what happened in 1918 to make it an important date in the history of women's rights? A, women were made legally responsible for their children's crimes. B, wives were given the right to keep their own earnings and property. C, laws guaranteeing equal pay were passed. Or D, women were given the right to vote. The correct answer is women were given the right to vote. So Zizi came to say hello. She just sat down in front of the camera. Say hi, everyone. Good luck on your Life in the UK test. So for this next part of the video, I want to talk about my experience of taking the Life in the UK test during the global pandemic. So this means that there was social distancing involved, there was closures of centers because of everything that was happening. So yeah, it was not easy to book in my Life in the UK test. So what I have to say in my experience is book in your test early and as soon as possible. So it took me about 4 to 6 weeks for me to find a center close by that was able to actually book me in for the test. So there are about 30 centers all across the UK that you can go in and book in for this official test. But I have to say, most of the centers in London there was about a 4 to 6 week waiting period. So if you are keen on taking your test, book it in ASAP so you can just have the date and time and then study from there. So when I first arrived at the test center, I arrived about 15 to 20 minutes early. I would highly recommend showing up early. Obviously, it's important to be early, not late. And also with all the different, you know, rules in place around social distancing, it's so important to make sure that you are there early, following all the guidelines and making sure that everything is in order before you go in for your test. Now, because of social distancing and because of everything that's happening right now, they have a rolling entry. So I arrived about 15 minutes before, about actually more like 20 minutes before my test actually started, and they allowed me to come in and I went through the process there. So when you come in, what they first do is they check your ID that you signed up for your test online. So for me, that was my residence permit or my BPR. So they checked to make sure that my name and my birth date aligned with their list of people that were gonna take the test on that day at that time. Then I was asked to sit and wait until a woman called me into a room, and she called me into a room and asked me to take off my jacket or any outerwear that was clothing I was wearing, and also my handbag, and put it on a table and then show her my ID. She then asked me to verbally confirm my name and date of birth. She looked up at me, she made sure that the picture matched who I was, and then she took a picture of me and asked me to sign a consent form. After that, she then pat me down. So they definitely check all your bags and they kind of pat you down to make sure that you have, you know, no recording devices, you don't have a phone or anything like that, and they just you know, double check. This is an official like government test and they want to make sure no one is cheating. So they definitely check you for all of that. Once they do that, they ask you to take all your items of clothes, your handbag, anything that you brought with you and put it into a locker. They also make you take off your smartwatch and turn your phone completely off. They make you turn it off and then they put everything in a locker, you lock it up, and the only thing you're allowed to keep is your ID card. You're then asked to sit and wait until you are called into a room. So once my name was called out, I was then asked to come into a room and sit down at a computer. And now when you sit down at that computer, it's just a screen and a mouse. You don't need the keyboard. They have sanitized everything because of all the measures in place to make sure everyone is socially distanced and staying clean and healthy. Then the lady actually pre-entered my BPR number into the screen and then logged me in, and she said I can start whenever I'm ready. So there was no timer that started until I was ready. So once I sat down, the lady also asked me to confirm all my details. So it had like my name and my BPR number, and once I hit ready and it was submit, that is when it actually kicked off. So once that happens, you are then led to a screen where it will give you exact directions on what you can expect for the entire test. So it'll give you a breakdown of the next and like how to flag a question and how the whole thing works. Once you go through the instructions and directions, you are then given 2 to 3 practice questions. So these are completely practice. They don't go to your overall score. They don't help you, but they also don't hurt you as well. They're there to make sure that you understand what to click when you are clicking a correct answer, how to click the next button, and also how to flag a question. Also, on the practice questions, don't worry about how long you take to read directions or go through those practice questions, because your timer doesn't start until you hit question 1. So that 45 timer actually is on the top right hand of the corner of the screen, and you won't actually see it tick down until you hit go. Also, another thing I have to say is when you are going through these questions, what I would recommend is going through each one of the questions, answer it, read it, make sure you understand it, and then answer it with your best answer. If you definitely know it's right, cool, move on to the next question. But if you have any hesitation or you don't know what the answer is, there's an option to flag that question. And when you flag it, you're able to go back and review that question. But you can review all 24. What the great part of this test is you can go through every single question and answer it as many times or change your answers as many times as you'd like. You actually can go back and forth, and then the only time that the test is finished is when you actually hit the end and submit button. So feel free to go backwards, forward as many times as you want. But what I would recommend is answer all the questions you know. Don't second guess yourself on those ones. Just answer them and be done with them. Because if you know that information, when you go back to it 2 or 3 times again and again, you're gonna second guess yourself. So if you know it, cool, move on. But if you have those questions where you have a moment of self-doubt, or you maybe think it could be A or C or maybe D, then just flag it, move on to the next question, and then come back to it later. Again, all I have to say is please, please, please don't rush. You have 45 minutes for 24 questions. Take your time. Read every question, really understand it, really think back to the dates and the people and the names and the places, and make sure you have it all in line. And on the questions that you don't know, that you flagged, come back and just take your time. By that point, you'll probably still have 20, maybe even 30 minutes to review everything. So just take your time and know that as you go through each one of those flagged questions, it'll probably, your memory will have a moment of recall and you will probably remember exactly what happened. Just give yourself a minute to calm down, bring the nerves down, reread that question, and you'll probably know it. So once you're happy with all your questions, like I said, there is a submit or end button to the test. Once you submit, that's it. The screen goes kind of blank, and that's it. That's the end of your test. You don't get any results right then and there. Once you finish, you let the lady know who's like monitoring the room that you're done, and then she'll escort you back downstairs or back into a separate room, and that is where you can go pick up all your belongings, all your stuff from your locker. And at that point, you actually can leave. Because of everything that's happening with the pandemic, they are not giving paper certificates of pass or fail. What they are doing is they're allowing you to log in online with your username and everything that you created on the website that you booked the site on, and there you're able to see if you passed or failed. If you're super anxious like me, I did actually ask the guy, I was like, hey, do you know if I passed or failed? Because I was waiting for my phone to turn back on. He's like, yeah, you passed. So that was great. So remember that you can check almost immediately after your test. You just have to turn on your phone, log into their website, and then you'll see a pass or fail. If you have failed, it's okay, not the end of the world. You can retake the test 7 days later and you have to pay 50 pounds again, but you do have to wait for 7 days. But if you have passed at that point, congratulations, woo, go you. You have now passed your test and you can now apply for your indefinite leave to remain or your British citizenship. So guys, that's it. That was my entire experience of taking my life in the UK test while in a global pandemic during lockdown. And I have to say, I was so excited when I passed because again, I studied for it. I was so excited for it and yeah, I passed, so that was really exciting. I have now applied for my indefinite leave to remain visa. I'm actually waiting to hear back from the Home Office. If you guys wanna see more videos about being an American abroad or an American in London or my entire visa process here in London and in the UK, I'll be sure to link everything down in the description below. Also, link it up in the cards for you guys to check out those videos. If you did get value from this video and you enjoyed it, then please do give this video a thumbs up so I know to create more content like this for you guys. And if you're someone who's viewing this and you are gonna take your life in the UK test soon, just breathe, relax, you're gonna do great, and good luck. Anyways guys, if you made it to this point of the video and you haven't already subscribed, please consider smashing that subscribe button and turn on the bell notification so you know exactly when my next video is going live. I do upload 2 times a week on Sundays and Wednesdays, and I upload tons of videos about being an American abroad, about being an expat, about my experience in the UK, and I will be uploading quite a few videos on my indefinite leave to remain visa. So stay tuned for that. Anyways, guys, I'll catch you guys in my next video. Bye.